Good morning, students. Today I will be talking about the last part of regional circulation in the cardiovascular system, that is cutaneous, muscle and splanchnic circulations. These are minor topics but very important in the exam point of view. First, we will see the cutaneous circulation. Cutaneous blood vessels form a dense network under the dermis layer of the skin. So the first one is the branches of arterioles, that is meta-arterioles, are highly resistant conduits present between the arterioles and the capillaries. And the cutaneous capillaries, these divide into capillary loops which provide a large surface area for heat exchange. And the venules form an intensive venous plexus which hold large quantity of blood and lie parallel to the surface of the skin and play important role in maintaining the body temperature. And the arteriovenous anastomoses are located in the distal part of extremities like hands and feet, nose, lips and ear lobules. These are wide, low resistant connections that serve as shunts and allow blood to bypass the superficial capillary loops and play major role during the control of body temperature. The characteristic features of the cutaneous blood flow are: the main function is to aid in the regulation of body temperature, and the metabolic rate of the skin is relatively small so that minimal amount of blood flow to the skin can supply the nutritive function. In the resting cutaneous blood flow, that is when the person is at rest, it is about 10 to 15 ml per minute per 100 gram of skin tissue. And during exposure to cold, when sweating is very minimal, the cutaneous blood flow falls to about 1/10 of the resting blood flow, that is 1 ml per minute per 100 gram tissue. And during exposure to heat, the blood flow may increase to 10 times of the resting value, that is about 150 ml per minute per 100 gram tissue. This imposes a heavy circulatory load on the heart. And the regional variation in cutaneous blood flow exists due to the presence of AV anastomoses in abundance in certain areas such as hands, feet, nose and ear lobules. During heat stress, the blood flow to the area with rich AV anastomoses increases much more as compared to the rest of the skin. And coming to the cutaneous blood flow and any relation with the skin color, the color of skin is basically determined by the pigment melanin, and the amount of blood and degree of oxygenation affect the skin color tinge, which may be reddish, bluish or some shade in between. And then the regulation of cutaneous blood flow. As you all know, skin has very little metabolic activity and therefore it consumes very little oxygen, that is only 0.3 ml per minute per 100 grams. So the cutaneous blood flow is predominantly regulated by nervous mechanisms rather than the metabolic mechanism. The nerve supply of the skin blood vessels is by sympathetic vasoconstrictor fibers supplying the vessels exhibit a sympathetic constrictor discharge under resting condition. It is more marked on the AV anastomosis vessels than the other vessels. And the parasympathetic vasodilator fibers do not supply the cutaneous blood vessels. And then how the vasodilation of cutaneous blood vessels occurs means by decrease in the sympathetic vasoconstrictor effect and also local production of some vasodilators like bradykinin, etc. And the neural control mechanisms are of three types: by the hypothalamus and the baroreceptor mediated reflex and the cortical control mechanisms. So the first one, hypothalamic control mechanism. As you already know that hypothalamus function is one of the important function, that is thermoregulation. So how does the hypothalamus does this function? Under resting conditions, when the person is at the thermal equilibrium with the environment, the sympathetic tone normally keeps the AV anastomosis closed. and then during exposure to heat, this tonic discharge is reflexly abolished by hypothalamic mechanism. Thus, the flow to the skin is increased by in the following steps. The AV anastomosis first dilate due to reduction in the tonic discharge, and then rest of the cutaneous vessels dilate due to progressive withdrawal of the vasoconstrictor activity, and thirdly, the sweat glands get activated due to cholinergic sympathetic discharge. The bradykinin produced by the secretory activity of the sweat glands acts locally as a powerful vasodilator and increases blood flow to the skin. So all these steps combinedly increase the cutaneous blood flow to as high as 150 ml/min/100 g. So thus, the total cutaneous blood flow during heat stress may be over 3 liters/min. So this heat increased blood flow carries the heat to the surface of the body, which is dissipated by radiation, evaporation and conduction to the environment. And then similarly, during the exposure to cold, the opposite happens. The tonic discharge is increased in markedly decreasing the blood flow to as low as 1 ml/min/100 g. Okay, and the next one is baroreceptor mediated reflex. So the cutaneous blood vessels participate in the baroreceptor mediated reflex during conditions of circulatory stress such as exercise and hemorrhage. They exhibit considerable vasoconstriction and act as compensatory mechanism to divert the blood from periphery to the central pool. So during the stress conditions like exercise and hemorrhage, where more blood is required because of considerable vasoconstriction, this skin circulations, the blood flow present in the skin is diverted to the central pool, that is to heart and brain, the main important vital organs. And the next one is cortical control mechanisms. The emotions affect the cutaneous circulation through cortico-hypothalamic pathway. So cortex, how does it control the cutaneous blood flow? That is through emotions. And the pathway is cortico-hypothalamic. The impulses are relayed from the cortico-hypothalamic centers to the thoracolumbar sympathetic cell bodies and thence to the skin vessels. So the effect of emotions manifest in following forms. One is blanching and other is blushing. Blanching of skin occurs during situations of fear, pale with fear. It occurs due to vasoconstriction through the cortical mechanism. And blushing occurs, so blushing is otherwise called emotional embarrassment, which occurs due to dilation of the blood vessels. It is supposed to be result of bradykinin, a potent vasodilator released secondary to a brief cortico-hypothalamically controlled discharge of sympathetic cholinergic fibers to the sweat glands. So basically, blanching is vasoconstriction, which occurs due to vasoconstriction, and blushing occurs because of vasodilation. Here the potent vasodilator is bradykinin. And both these mechanisms are mediated by cortico-hypothalamic pathway. And coming to the cutaneous vascular responses, like white reaction, triple response, dermatographia, reactive hyperemia, cold vasodilation and cold vasoconstriction. So what is this white reaction? It refers to appearance of a pale stroke line when pointed object is drawn lightly over the skin. This occurs because of the mechanical stimulates, initiates contraction of the precapillary sphincter, and blood drains out of the capillaries and small veins. It appears in about 15 seconds. And the triple response, it is also called triple vascular response of T. Lewis. Lewis is the scientist who discovered this. So there are three responses seen. One is redness, flare and wheal. So what are these three reactions? It consists, it occurs as a normal reaction to skin, which is more in intensity than that simply causes white reaction. So in other words, even when the skin is stroked more firmly with a pointed instrument, instead of white reaction, there occurs triple response. So the first one, redness, it depends on soluble chemical mediator. It occurs due to dilation of precapillary sphincters in the injured area. It is not mediated by nerves but is produced by histamines or some polypeptides like bradykinin released from the damaged skin. And the flare, next one, depends upon the nerve supply. It refers to diffusely spreading and irregularly outlined redness of the skin surrounding the red line. So it occurs after a few minutes. The first one, red reaction, occurs within 10 seconds and the flare reaction occurs within after the few minutes of appearance of red line. And it occurs due to dilation of arteriole and precapillary sphincters. And that dilation of arteriole increases the local blood flow. Since the blockade of the concerned afferent nerve fibers away from the site of injury does not abolish the response, it is believed that flare is mediated by the axon reflex in the cutaneous fibers, which does not involve the CNS like a typical reflex. So what is this axon reflex? We'll see that in the next slide. And the wheel, third response is the wheel. It depends on the soluble chemical mediator. The first one, redness, and wheel depends on the chemical mediators, whereas the flare depends on the nerve supply. It occurs because of the dilation of the arterioles and precapillary sphincters. And the wheel response, it refers to the swelling or localized edema that develops within the area of flare when stroke stimulus is very strong. It occurs due to increased capillary permeability with consequent extravasation of fluid. Here, the fluid is extravasating from the vessel. Increase in the permeability responsible for the wheel formation is in part by the histamine or histamine-like substance released from the local mast cells. So thus there is histaminergic as well as peptidergic component of the wheel. Okay, so here histamine, bradykinin, here also mostly it is histamine. So flare is because of nerve supply, depends on the nerve supply. That is again dilatation of the arteriole and precapillary sphincters. So in this picture you can see the appearance of the red reaction is about 10 seconds and this is after the few minutes and the last one to appear is wheel. So in the red reaction, how it appears? It appears like a red line, whereas a flare, it is a diffusely spreading irregular redness and the wheel is localized edema. The cause for the red reaction is precapillary dilatation and the flare is dilatation of arterioles and precapillary sphincters and the wheel is increased permeability and also sphincters extravasation of fluid. And the control is here red reaction, no neural control. Bradykinin is the main thing and the flare, neural control, and the wheel, local response of histamine and histamine-like substances released by mast cells. So if you remember this picture, you can easily write the triple response in the exam. So axon reflex is otherwise called antidromic conduction. So normally, what is orthodromic? The conduction of normal sensory afferent impulses from skin to spinal cord is called orthodromic conduction. But in certain situations, like when a firm stroke is applied across the skin, the efferent impulses in sensory nerves from the skin are relayed antidromically down the branches of sensory nerves that innervate the blood vessels. Okay, so actually from the skin to the spinal cord, this is orthodromic conduction. But this impulses are going antidromically to the blood vessels of the skin. This antidromic conduction of impulses causes release of substance P from the nerve endings, which produce vasodilation and increase the capillary permeability. Here it will produce substance P, which is the reason of increasing vasodilation and capillary permeability. So So this local neural mechanism, which does not involve the CNS, is called axon reflex. It is responsible for the local vasodilation. Okay, so this one is the axon reflex, which is responsible for the redness reaction, flare reaction of the triple response. So this picture is dermatographia, which refers to striking triple response. So it is a triple response, but is very striking, that occurs as an unusual reaction in some individuals. So some individuals are prone to this dermatographia. So in those individuals, anything drawn on the skin, even with a blunt point, becomes visible, that is conspicuous, within few minutes. The exact cause is not known, but it is possibly due to excessive release of histamine in these prone individuals. And the reactive hyperemia is nothing but if you occlude a part for some time and then release the occlusion, there is immediately a reactive hyperemia, that is fiery red, appearance of reddish color in the involved part because of increased blood flow to the part. So it is a phenomenon by which vessels control blood flow to the organ after a period of ischemia following occlusion of the artery. So this response occurs in many organs, but it is mainly visible in the skin. So if you take the example of occluding the blood supply to a limb, the arterioles below the occlusion dilate. And when the circulation is re-established, the blood flowing into the dilated vessels make the skin appear fiery red. And the magnitude and duration of reactive hyperemia depends upon the duration of occlusion. And the cause for this reactive hyperemia is due to the local effect of hypoxia. So here in this picture, you can see the cold vasodilation. So normally during cold exposure, there occurs widespread cutaneous vasoconstriction via hypothalamic mechanism. But prolonged and severe vasoconstriction leads to tissue damage known as frostbite. So this occurs usually when the temperature falls below 10 degrees. The tissue injury produced is very painful and associated with release of histamine and other polypeptides, which excite the sensory terminals and produce vasodilation due to axon reflex. So in addition to the exposure to cold, there is formation of plasma kinins, which also produce vasodilation. And the next one is cold vasoconstriction. Exposure to cold causes vasoconstriction again via hypothalamus. So it results in decreased nutrient supply to skin and decreases the metabolic rate of tissue. Due to decreased metabolism, the metabolites accumulation is very slow. Unlike in the muscle, local metabolites of skin are not able to produce local vasodilation and oppose or escape the sympathetic vasoconstriction. As a result, maximal vasoconstrictor discharge to the precapillary resistant vessels of the skin is well sustained. So prolonged cold induced vasoconstriction, especially in damp condition, result in cutaneous ischemia producing lesions such as trench foot. So here you can see constriction of vessels decreases blood supply to fingers, causing them to turn pale. Coming to the skeletal muscle circulation, at rest, blood flow to the skeletal muscle is 2 to 4 ml per minute per 100 gram, that is about 750 to 800 ml per minute of the total muscle mass. So during strenuous exercise, blood flow can increase up to 20 times, that is 50 to 80 ml per minute per 100 gram muscle tissue, or over 20 liters per minute to the whole body skeletal mass. So this is called exercise hyperemia. So the cause for this is local metabolite induced vasodilation, that is dilatation of arteriole and precapillary sphincters. So during exercise, all the dormant capillaries open up along with the arterioles and precapillary sphincter dilatation, which greatly increases the surface area and the rate of blood flow. And the Blood flow to the muscle during exercise is intermittent. So blood flow to the muscles is intermittent, and in the lower limbs, calf muscle help the upward blood flow. Why? Because during relaxation, the blood is not coming back, and during contraction of the muscle, the blood vessel is constricted. They squeeze the blood vessels passing through them, and thus blood flow decreases or even stops. And during relaxation, blood flow increases, and the myoglobin acts as an O2 acceptor, and it yields its oxygen to the fibrils during the subsequent muscle contraction. So the blood flow is intermittent because during contraction, the blood flow ceases or even stops, and during relaxation, it goes up. And then the reactive hyperemia is a phenomenon by which vessels control blood flow to the organ after a period of ischemia following occlusion. So as I have already told you in the cutaneous circulation, same here. The blood supply to the limb is occluded, the muscular or cutaneous arterioles below the occlusion dilate. And when the circulation is re-established, the blood flowing into the dilated vessels cause muscle hyperemia, and also in cutaneous blood vessels, it is cutaneous hyperemia. So the responsible vessels for this is arterioles and precapillary sphincter dilatation mediated by local hypoxia. Coming to the regulation of this muscle blood flow, this occurs by three mechanisms: autoregulation, metabolic control, and nervous control. The first one is autoregulation. As you already know, autoregulation means maintaining its own blood flow without any change, without altering to the changing blood pressure. So it is well established in the skeletal muscles also, like the kidney, heart, and rate. The precapillary vessels in the skeletal muscle have high basal myogenic tone. So a rise in the transmural pressure excite a stretch induced contraction of the sphincter smooth muscles, which by raising the precapillary vessel tone protects the capillaries from an undue rise of pressure. So the flow is remaining constant because of both the pressure and resistance are increasing equally. So that is the mechanism, myogenic mechanism of the autoregulation. And next, coming to the metabolic theory. So when the vessel is in inactive form, it is vasoconstricted in the absence of excessive metabolites. And the active tissues release metabolites like carbon dioxide, ADP, and organic acid, which cause vasodilation, bringing the more blood to the tissues. So this is called exercise hyperemia, which occurs especially in the exercising muscles. So because of muscle contraction, which increases the metabolic rate of tissue, that causes reduction in the oxygen concentration in the muscle. So which reduction in the oxygen concentration leads to vasodilation, and also because of release of metabolites like CO2, ADP, and acids. And also one more factor is increase in the temperature because of muscular activity. So as a result, there is 10 to 100 fold increase in the number of open capillaries in the skeletal muscle blood circulation. So that causes increased blood flow to the muscles. That is metabolite control mechanism. And next one is the nervous control. So it is supplied by both sympathetic vasoconstrictor and vasodilator fibers. So the vasoconstrictor fibers discharge at rate of 1 impulse and 2 to 3 impulses in recumbent and upright position. It contributes relatively small part to the high basal tone of resistant vessels of the muscles. And most of the basal tone of these vessels is myogenic. And during exercise, it is obvious that exercise hyperemia is independent of sympathetic discharge, but it is mainly due to the metabolic factors. And during this vasoconstrictor fibers are very much important during circulatory shock and other types of circulatory stress, which causes the blood flow from the muscles to divert to the main vital organs of the body like heart and brain. So that is happening because of sympathetic vasoconstriction, which reduces the blood flow to the muscles. And then the vasodilator fibers, they have ACH, acetylcholine, as a neurotransmitter, and they are activated by cortico-hypothalamic reticulospinal pathways. These operate during the emergencies because during mental stress, emotions and stimulation of different areas in hypothalamus occurs, causing vasodilation in the muscles. The vasodilator fibers play no significant role in increasing the blood flow, either during or before. But they play an important role in preventing the sudden rise in blood pressure at the beginning of exercise, that is by providing a safety valve mechanism. So what is this safety valve mechanism? Because at the beginning of exercise, there is increased sympathetic activity because of anxiety. So there is increase in stroke volume and heart rate, but which again causes increase the blood pressure. But this increase in blood pressure is not happening because discharge of vasodilator fibers increases, and which reduces the total peripheral resistance, lowering the blood pressure. So that is the safety valve mechanism of vasodilator fibers of the blood vessels. And the next one is splanchnic circulation. It includes the vascular beds of intestines, pancreas, spleen and liver. So the main vessels which constitute splanchnic circulation are the arteries supplying to the blood to the intestine, pancreas, spleen and liver, which include celiac trunk and the superior mesenteric artery and inferior mesenteric artery, and also hepatic portal system formed by the veins draining the blood from the abdominal part of GIT. And the hepatic veins emerging from the liver tissue, which end in the inferior vena cava. And coming to the blood flow, about 1100 ml of portal blood enters the liver each minute, and 350 ml of blood from the hepatic artery enters the liver each minute. Therefore, the total blood flow is 1450 ml, or 29% of the circulating blood flow. And the oxygen consumption during rest is approximately 20 to 35% of the body's total needs. So this is a picture. You can see hepatic veins from the inferior vena cava into the liver, and then the portal vein. So the bracket numbers are average blood flow per minute. So this is portal vein receives blood from the stomach, spleen, pancreas, small intestine, colon, etc. And the artery, aorta, from the aorta, celiac artery gives 700 ml per minute, and superior mesenteric 1500 and inferior mesenteric 300. So total it's about 1500 ml per minute. In the intestinal circulation, it is constituted by blood supply to intestine and pancreas by a series of parallel circulation via branches of superior and inferior mesenteric arteries. So extensive anastomoses are present between the vessels, constituting the mesenteric circulation. So the blood flow to the intestinal mucosa is much more than that of the rest of the intestinal wall. The counter current system exists in the capillaries and venules in the villus. That is, the direction of blood flow in the capillaries and venules in the villus is opposite to that of the main arteriole. So this system has both advantages and disadvantages. So what are the advantages? It slows down the entrance of rapidly absorbed solutes into the blood. And then how it slows down means the lipid soluble substances, when carried in the venous descending limb of the vascular hairpin loop, pass by diffusion across into the ascending arterial limb because of a concentration gradient. And the disadvantage of the counter current system is that it decreases partial pressure of oxygen at the tip of villi. So this counter current mechanism helps in absorption of the nutrients while the blood is flowing through ascending, it is absorbed into the descending. And also the disadvantage is that at the tip of the villus there is decreased PO2. And the regulation of the intestinal secretion is by local chemical control, that is functional hyperemia. During increased intestinal activity, there occur marked increase in intestinal blood flow. So the gastrin, secretin, bradykinin, hormones of the GIT are secreted from the mucosal glands, causing local vasodilation and augment the blood flow. And neural regulation is by the vessels are richly innervated by noradrenergic sympathetic nerve fibers, which have mild tonic discharge that causes moderate vascular resistance in splanchnic vessels. The main role of neural regulation of splanchnic vessel is in time of cardiovascular crisis. Again, that is during hemorrhage or shock times, again the blood flow is diverted to the vital organs. And also autoregulation, which adjusts the vascular resistance and relatively constant blood flow maintenance over a wide range of arterial, is also well developed in the mesenteric vessels like that of kidney, brain, heart and skeletal muscles. So it is mainly metabolic mechanisms. So that's all for today. Thank you all.